What is the gift of nature that links music, a carver, a sawmill, a splintering clarinet, and the wildlife of East Africa? It's the wood of the Mpingo tree, the tree that makes music. The Mpingo is, at first glance, like most of the other trees of the African savannah, an unassuming, thorny, gnarled, yellowish tree. But it contains not only one of its own country's greatest treasures, but from it comes some of the loveliest sounds to be heard in the concert halls of Europe. It grows in a type of woodland that once stretched from South Africa to Ethiopia, but now survives only in Tanzania and northern Mozambique. It's very slow growing and long-lived. Some trees may be centuries old. It's also an important barrier against spreading deserts and a valuable factor in the fertility of this land, for its roots carry nodules that enrich the soil. At the end of each dry season, its short burst of new growth provides much-needed food for the plains animals. It may not look very impressive, but in its centre is a remarkable wood that has been traded along the East African coast since the ancient Egyptians sought it to make ceremonial staffs, furniture and ornaments. It's the national tree of Tanzania. The Makonde people, who live in the remoter parts of southern Tanzania, have also had a long traditional bond with this wood. This man and his sons, two or three times a year, go into the bush to start searching for the best tree in the neighborhood, for they are carvers. The ideal Mpingo tree should be straight and flawless. It must be big enough to justify the labor of cutting it down, and that means it should be at least 60 years old, but not too big to carry home. Judgment, experience and skill is needed to make sure that the tree will fall cleanly and land exactly on the cushion of branches that has been laid for it to prevent the shock of the fall from splintering and cracking it. The heartwood, for which this tree is so prized, is as black as jet and almost as hard and heavy as iron. Anything made from it is immensely strong. It goes under many names: African blackwood, ebony, even black ivory. It's so tough that the axe needs sharpening every few minutes. It's thirsty work, and the land is harsh and dry. But those who know this bush know how to get a drink from it, by cutting a particular vine that is full of water. After 2 hours of hard labor, the tree is still holding on by a thread.
Yeah.
The Makonde are expert carvers, and the heartwood of the Mpingo is very important in their lives. But the Mpingo plays an important part in Western culture, too.
1, 2, 3, 4.
When you look at a jazz band, or for that matter an orchestra, what you're looking at is a tiny ebony forest, because the fingerboards and the chin rests of string instruments and the black notes on a keyboard of a piano, and of course especially the bodies of woodwind instruments, oboes, clarinets, are all made in the top instruments from Mpingo wood. What you're hearing is nature's voice, a direct connection between nature and music. In this case, the connection couldn't be more direct. Here's a marvelous material, this wonderful black wood, which has proved to be the ideal material for making these, to making woodwind instruments, particularly clarinets. And it's for that reason, for those unique tonal qualities and sheer glamour of this material, that makers have been, since the 19th century, making instruments from this wood on an industrial scale.
Among the sawmills scattered along the southern coast of Tanzania, there are a few that specialise in processing Mpingo logs. Teams of foresters in the bush provide this mill with about 600 trees every week. The customers for the sawn wood, the European instrument makers, demand the highest quality, so that only the best parts of the trees will do. The wood takes as heavy a toll on the teeth of the saw as on the carver's axe. Nor does the character of the tree make life easy for the millers. It's very twisted and full of flaws that make extracting high-quality timber extremely difficult. It takes considerable experience to extract the best parts efficiently, and even then the graders still reject a very high proportion. At least 90% of the tree ends up on the scrap pile. But once sealed and bagged, the wood that passes the selection is like gold bullion, the most expensive timber in the world, worth $10,000 per cubic meter. In the poor, parched country of southern Tanzania, water is a vital commodity. But the Mpingo is almost as crucial. For carved by Makonde sculptors, it brings essential income to many of the families here. The extra revenue has allowed this family to build a hamlet for themselves and has made them relatively wealthy. Their single, carefully selected tree may last 6 months. Very little of this wood is wasted. The offcuts will be made into curios or even chess pieces, whilst the larger pieces are worked into elaborate sculptures. The Makonde think very highly of the Mpingo. The strength and hardness of its wood makes carving very laborious, but it also allows the finished pieces to be intricate and fine. Mze Hendricks has been a carver for 30 years. Now an acknowledged artist, his sculptures are both highly imaginative and symbolic. A style of sculpture called Shetani that often feature Mahoka, ghosts of dead ancestors who were witches when they were alive.
Ni watu wanapotea kweli kwa sababu vitu kama hivi.
Na ulipata mawazo gani ya kutengeneza kitu kama hiki? Na wewe bado hujaona?
Mawazo baada ya kulala usingizi alafu unaweza kuona kila kitu. Kitu kikubwa kama hiki.
Ndio.
Alafu unapoona, alafu unaweza kukumbuka na kuchonga pia.
Unaweza kuchukua muda gani labda kutengeneza kitu kama hiki?
Ni muda mrefu zaidi kama kwa kutengeneza kama miezi 6 hivi. Ndiyo. Kwa kufikiria au kwa kukumbuka vile vile.
Na hapa juu ni kitu gani hapa juu?
Hapa juu ni kitu kama huyu, ni watu wa moja wanashirikiana kukamata watu. Polini.
The carving skills are passed from father to son, but it's only the imagination of the artist that can make the flowing lines of the sculpture live. In the outskirts of Paris, a new consignment of Mpingo blanks from Tanzania is about to arrive at the Boothie and Hawks factory of Buffet Crampon.
Pavillon de bois. Les cordes basses.
Traditional methods and modern scientific techniques have mixed and combined over the last 100 years to produce a series of secret processes for drying and seasoning the wood. The treated wood is laid down for at least a year to season and mature before it's brought back to the factory to start the long process that will transform it into a clarinet. The special quality of the wood is that it behaves like something inorganic, almost like metal. It can be turned on a lathe, it can be cut with the great precision necessary for the placing of the finger holes, it will even accept the bore for screw threads. Exceptional stability under the unfriendly extremes of temperature and humidity inherent in the life of a wind instrument, and it polishes to a beautiful sheen. Because each piece has its own individual character, it needs a craftsman's hand and eye to get the best out of it and turn it into an instrument with its own distinct personality. The wood still retains its organic nature, and when it comes alive again as a clarinet, it shows off its most pleasing character, its warm and beguiling musical tone. Michel Arignon is a top French concert clarinetist employed by Bouffe Crampon to put their elite instruments through their paces.
En fait, là, j'ai changé deux fois le pavillon parce que la qualité du son est bonne. Mais on cherchait à avoir un plus grand son par rapport à la moyenne des clarinettes. Et maintenant, je vais le tourner pour chercher le point où il va sonner le mieux. Et pourquoi ? Parce que ces deux parties-là, l'intérieur est fait d'une seule fois, mais pas cette partie-là. Donc il faut essayer de trouver l'endroit où ça va le mieux s'accorder avec cette partie-là. Je le fais. Moi bien. Je crois qu'en fa. Non, ça retient, oui, ça. C'est mieux, ça. Peut-être en passer un autre quand même. Mais je vais le mettre de côté, celui-ci. C'est mieux ça, non ?
Once matched and fine-tuned, this gift of the forest is ready to make music.
Since 45 years, I'm in the woodwind manufacturing business. Mpingo wood is still cracking. It can be happened that the wood has a little hair crack, and then when you're putting into the lathe, it's starting cracking. And you have a scrap rate of about 20%. We don't know what's causing really these cracks, but when you're considering that this piece costing you $10, we like to know why.
Natural wildfires have always swept this land. Every dry season, they strike at random. The Mpingo is one of the many trees that has become adapted to withstand the swift passage of occasional grass fire. Its bark may be scarred, but it remains very much alive. But if scorched too often, it may nurse beneath the skin hidden damage to its heartwood, the cracks that, years later, caused such problems on the clarinet maker's lathe. Like nature, we humans have used fire to change the environment for our own particular purpose. The balanced relationship evolved over millennia between living things and fire has crucially shifted. Expensive nuisance to the instrument maker, but to the environmentalist, they are indicators of a major environmental problem, something of deep concern to botanist Sebastian Choa.
Sehemu hii ilikuwa situ mzuri sana, lakini kutokana na moto uliotokea hapa kama wiki moja iliyopita, imemaliza ule msitu wote mzuri na umeisha. Mti kama huu mpingo umeweza kubakia hapa baada ya moto kumaliza miti yote midogo iliyokuwa hapa. Kwa hiyo, mti kama huu utaendelea kubaki. Hii ni matatizo yanayotokana na moto, hasa moto uliotokea hapa karibu katika vijiji vya jirani, karibu na msitu huu, na ukaweza kuingia na kumaliza miti yote katika msitu huu.
Man-made fires, added to those that occur naturally, have so increased the frequency of burning that now young trees are killed before they have a chance to grow big enough to become fire-resistant. And as Tanzania's rapidly increasing population demands more and more food, so farmers are burning the land indiscriminately to clear woodland for crops as well as to stimulate new shoots for cattle. Sebastian is the botanist of the Tanzania Wildlife Society, one of a small group of naturalists who are determined to do what they can to protect Tanzania's forests. He's worried that the Mpingo is under attack from just too many directions.
Sasa miti kama hii ikiwa kama itauawa na moto na ile miti mikubwa kama ule wawa tuliouona ukakatwa kwa ajili ya kuchongwa vinyago na kazi nyingine, ina maana baada ya muda mfupi miti yote itakuwa imeisha. Hivyo basi kuna haja ya kuotesha mpingo.
So is the Mpingo going to vanish from the African landscape for good?
Well, it's not an endangered species in the same way we talk of elephants or rhinos or whales being endangered species. But with trees, you don't have to be on the brink of extinction to be under threat. If the standing stock of this tree isn't topped up at a rate that will sustain a harvest, then the tree will become, in effect, commercially or economically extinct. And that may not sound like a desperate threat, but experience in the past with other woods like teak, mahogany, has shown that once this economic extinction occurs, literal or biological extinction often isn't far behind.
The problem is already beginning to affect the lives of the carvers. Trees that will yield wood good enough for sculpture are now hard to find locally.
Tulifika hapa kwa kutoka kule mbali kwa sababu nyumba kule ilikuwa mpingo karibu. Ulikuwa mpingo karibu huko. Sasa baada mafundi walikuwa wengi na ikawa mpingo kule umekwisha na tunaendelea na kuchonga huu mpingo. Na mpingo huko hapa. Ndio maana tumetoka mbali kufika hapa kuja kufuata huu mpingo na kuukata. Ndio maana yake tulipofika huko.
Okay. Pole pole. Oh. Pole pole. Wako mwingine kuna mwingine na mimi. Ndio, wako na matela.
And it will be a long way home too with such a weight. For the big commercial users, harvesting the tree is not getting any easier either. The logging trucks have to go 200 kilometers deep into the remote parts of the interior to find decent stands of trees. Even where there seems to be a lot of trees, the good ones with usable heartwood are few and far between.
Nobody knows how many Mpingo trees there are in Tanzania. The best guess I've seen on record is around 3 million trees. And the extraction rate, the number that are harvested every year, is somewhere between 20 and 30,000. That should mean, if the arithmetic was simple, that there are enough to go around for at least the next century. But as a matter of fact, only about 600,000 or 12 to 20% of those trees in the standing stock are suitable for harvesting at any one time. And they're not being replaced at the kind of rate that they ought to be. So that they're diminishing at 5% a year without being replaced. Unless something is done about this, within 20 years there won't be an Mpingo trade anymore.
There's a time trap. It takes at least 70 years for a sapling to grow into a commercially useful tree. The young trees that should provide the forests of tomorrow, and thus tomorrow's harvests, are just not surviving. Is the music industry worried?
We are very concerned about the future of the trees because Hussian Hawks, for example, is one of the largest manufacturers in clarinet, and with their subsidiary company Pouffier Crampon, making the Rolls Royce of the clarinet, it's our lifeblood. What alternative do we have to replace Mpingo wood if this is not available anymore? Plastic. But we know what kind of problem we have with the plastic, the pollution problems. Then there's the other way, finding another species of wood which we can use. To the best of my knowledge, in the moment, there's nothing available. And I cannot imagine that any professional player playing an instrument is not made out of Mpingo wood. Thank you.
I don't think a traditional lineup with a jazz band, I mean a 6-8-piece band with a front line of two brass, I don't think it sounds the same without the clarinet. Certainly a clarinet adds so much, especially on solos. I mean, you can get so much light and shade. And I don't really know too many bands, jazz bands, that don't use clarinet. The wood's so important. You get so many contrasts on the clarinet. You can play it fierce and up in the top, and nice and mellow in the bottom. You know, it's just, there's no substitute for it, I'm afraid. Plastic, I've tried, you know, and it makes a sound. It's all right, but I mean, it's got that warmth about it, that live sort of feel about it, wood. You can't beat it.
As well as there being no substitute for music lovers if the wood disappears, so there is no substitute in the African ecosystem if the living tree becomes extinct. The problems of conservation in East Africa tend to be seen solely in terms of the threat to the big game animals. A humble tree like the Mpingo may seem unimportant by comparison. But the animals and trees of the savannah have evolved in harmony, each conditioning the biology of the other. And disappearance of one element would be yet another break in the ecological web. A ban on the use of Mpingo isn't the answer, as it was for elephant ivory, where trade was the root of the problem. Even without trade pressure, fires will continue to kill Mpingo saplings, and the older trees will simply fall under the farmer's axe instead of the forester's. This would confirm Sebastian Choa's worst fears. He believes the problem must be approached from another direction, and he's begun to do what he can to stop the slide. He's persuaded local Dar es Salaam residents to give over parts of their gardens as nurseries for his young plants.
Hii ni sehemu tu ya miche 200 ya mpingo ambayo nimeiotesha na baadaye nategemea kuipeleka porini, msituni. Na kuitunza kabisa ili sipatwe na janga lolote la moto. Na baadaye tunategemea kwamba inaweza ikatumika kwa matumizi kwa mfano ya kutengenezaji vinyago, vyombo vya muziki. Hii ina maana basi ni hatua nzuri kabla ya hali haijawa mbaya zaidi ya mpingo.
Replanting and stopping fires is the first step to protecting the stocks of mpingo. And that, of course, will safeguard everything else living alongside the trees. Economically, a total ban on the use of the tree would be as hard on the Tanzanians whose lives revolve around it as if the tree actually disappeared. The country as a whole would suffer too. The total trade in instrument blanks is worth $1.5 million a year in foreign exchange. The tourist market for wooden curios is growing all the time, and carving provides an income for many hundreds of the people flooding into Dar es Salaam from the rural areas. There is no other work. The tree is all there is between these people and destitution. Top grade sculptures are now becoming much sought after by collectors. Europeans, Americans, and Japanese are developing such a taste for these artifacts that they can command $1,000 price tags. But it is the cultural value of the musical instruments and sculptures that will determine whether the tree is worth preserving commercially. And that suggests a role for music, both classical and jazz, in the future conservation of the Mpingo.
whatever you may feel our civilization, our society lacks, two things it really prizes above all else, and that's music and quality in music. You have a $1 trillion recording industry striving for the utmost fidelity in the reproduction of sound. You have a performers who dedicate their lives to the ultimate, making the ultimate sounds.